Hi, in this video we will learn about MOOCs and flipped classes. What is the MOOC all about and what are the components of the MOOC, what are the kinds of MOOCs and what are the advantages and disadvantages and what is this flipped class all about. So MOOC, as you might know, that it is Massive Open Online Courses. So this is an acronym, stands for MOOC, Massive Open Online Courses. So there is a huge shift towards online courses now post COVID-19. You might already know it's worldwide shift. So people are tremendously talking about MOOC and converting the existing university as well as college curricula into the MOOC. So it's extremely relevant topic. So massive means large enrollment numbers, typically more than 1,000. It's completely open, so no mandatory qualifications. It's open for all. That means that an unemployed youth without any formal education, no schooling, can also take a university level course. So that is the philosophy of the openness in it. Online means it's completely online. There is no offline component at all. So a person from Chile, for example, can take up my MOOC course and complete everything, all the course requirements from the Chile. And of course, it's a course. Course means structured course content. There is a proper syllabi and it's a structure, and there is an outcome, objective and outcome. So it's basically an outcome based learning pedagogical strategy. So it's an online course aimed at unlimited participation and open access via the web. So it's online and it's all interaction is happening through the web. Of course, you need to have an internet for it. The basic philosophy of any MOOC course is 3 A's. What are these 3 A's? Anytime, anyone, anywhere. So anytime means anytime you can take it. So you don't really have to be physically present in the class. So it's unlike a Zoom online class. For example, if your teacher is teaching the things through the Zoom or the Google Meet or Jitsi, so it's only a specified time, right? So if you miss that time, then of course you cannot take it. So MOOC doesn't work that way. MOOC is recorded, so you can watch anytime. So for example, it's very good if you are having a part-time job, after the job you can take whenever you're free. Or if you're a if you're a mother, for example, of a small infant, so whenever the infant is sleeping you can watch. It's highly advantageous. Anyone means, as I already told you, it's open for everybody, irrespective of the gender, race of the religion, ethnicity or economic status. It's open for everybody, so it's the beauty of that. And it's anywhere. So anywhere means wherever, like if you're traveling in a bus, commuting, if you're flying, for example, you can still watch those videos, right? If you save those videos, of course. So that's the beauty of it. So what is MOOC versus online course? There are a lot of confusion. Are all online courses MOOC? No. MOOC is by definition free and it's open, but online course can be closed, limited to certain individuals only, for example, students currently registered in an existing university. MOOC is usually limitless. There is no limit for it. Enrollees are usually in thousands, while online courses usually are much smaller, less than 100 typically, or even 100 to 200 max. One faculty cannot offer MOOC. So MOOC is a teamwork. You need a large team for developing one MOOC course. You need a team of instructional designer, teaching assistants, technical support, etc. So also need a web server with specialized software. So for online course, you don't need it. You can just do it yourself, right? Online courses are usually managed by the teachers herself or himself. So major MOOC providers in the world includes Coursera, edX, Cadence, Khan Academy, Code Academy, FutureLearn, a lot of MOOC providers in the world. So if I ask you how does the MOOC works, and one analogy would be, suppose you have never used Facebook in your entire life. So then now I provide an hour long lecture on how to use Facebook, and you're just looking at my lecture. Can you make anything out of it? No, it doesn't work that way. To learn anything, the practical thing is that the best way is to learn by practice. So whenever there is a practical component in the learning module or the GOR, it's better to learn by practice. So instead of spending some time explaining how the MOOC works, I strongly suggest you to enroll for a MOOC course. So in any of these earlier mentioned, for example, Coursera or edX, the MOOC providers. So if you have never taken a MOOC, go and complete a MOOC. That is the first baby step. So make sure you complete the whole MOOC. So the studies have shown that people enroll for a MOOC, but only 2% complete the course, any kind of MOOC if you take it. Rest 98% are dropout after a few days. So please don't do that. You know, many people simply register and after one or two days you completely forget about the existence of that MOOC and they don't even complete that MOOC. So you will miss out the experience of the whole MOOC, you know. So the max one, you know, the fun of the taking MOOC in my experience comes very near to the final exam. So you have already completed, you learned a lot, and of course you need to have a notebook also, you know. So and then you review the things and you become highly satisfied. Wow, I learned a lot of new things through this new MOOC. And then you take that course, and once you get the certificate, you know, you earn that certificate yourself. So that is the beauty of that MOOC, right? You should complete that MOOC. The one of the very interesting MOOC that I'm taking right now, well, I teach biology in the Central University of Punjab here in India, and I have no background in justice. So I'd like to take the MOOC interdisciplinary, you know, cross discipline. So one of the courses that I'm taking is called justice. I have really no background in law. And yeah, it's a fantastic course offered by the Harvard University. I strongly suggest everybody to take this course. Another very interesting course I can suggest anybody, irrespective of your discipline, is Elements of AI. This is a free course offered by University of Helsinki in Finland. It's one of the most popular, super popular MOOC course, and it's very interesting. The design element, I love this design because it's a minimalism that they followed, just like the Finnish culture. And the entire course doesn't really have even a video component. You will be surprised to know that there is no video, there is no audio, and still just a you know, immersive HTML5 interface will take you through the foundation of what the artificial intelligence is all about. It's a fantastic course, and of course digital upgrade is free. You don't have to pay for you know, course completion certificate, and that is also a credit, 2 credit, but of course the credit is not valid in here in India. Or elsewhere, I'm not even sure that in the European Union it's valid, but because international credit transfer mechanism are still in infancy in any kind of MOOC that you take. So MOOC contents include video lecture or audio lecture or plain text lecture or a mix of here, all, you know, all these things. So, and of course the lecture handouts, immersive HTML5, and video lecture could be talking head, like what you see now on the screen, right? You can see me talking, so that is called talking head. Or it could be interview, you know, if you're dealing that kind of like media studies, then interview is an excellent form. And screencasting means screen recording. Right now I'm recording my screen, of course. Or if you are teaching the students how to use Excel, for example, a logical function of the Excel, or how to perform a regression analysis in GraphPad Prism, all those things you would need to do a screencasting. Whiteboard record. So if you are more interested, and if you think yourself as much better expressive or much better in teaching, you know, during whiteboard, then of course you're welcome. You can perform all the whiteboard. Or you can do a mix of all these things, or even graphics. But many people have this misconception that if you use you know, very good graphics, then your MOOC course is going to be hugely successful. No way. The graphics is not that important in a MOOC course, and without a graphics also you can have a fantastic MOOC. One of the good example would be Elements of AI. There is no fancy graphics in that entire course, and still it's one of the best courses I've ever taken. So graphics is not that important, but graphics can help to understand the concepts, especially if you teach biology, you know, for example, the signal transduction. So some of these hard to understand concepts, graphics can be advantageous, but graphics cannot make a mediocre course, you know, MOOC course, you know, the best course or better course. So it doesn't work that way. And discussion forums are extremely important to foster two-way learning. So it's a very important component of any of the MOOC courses. You need to foster the discussion. You need to frequently interact with your students. So otherwise it doesn't help at all. So the students will not make any progress without interaction. And of course, you need to have an assessment. And assessment is also important for the student's reflection and ownership. So students should know that the pace of their progress, right? And if they don't know, are they really learning the things, then how can they make any progress in any of the MOOC courses? So assessment is also a very important thing. So as you can see in this three gear-like illustration, these are the three components of the lifelong learning. First component is informal learning. It's just like if you read a book, you know, that is called informal learning, or you watch a YouTube video. Now, non-formal learning is something like a structured content. It's like a YouTube playlist, starting from the basic, going towards advanced level. Or non-formal learning can also, another example would be going to a swimming instructor, local swimming pool. The instructor will not teach you how to do a backstroke, you know. He or she will teach you how to actually float in a water, body of water. So that is what, right? Step by step, baby step towards ultimate goal of swimming nicely. Or the scouts, you know, all these are non-formal learning. Another example would be GYD, a solution which I, in my last video, I have already explained what this Google, YouTube and Dropbox, an excellent solution. You can have a very interesting online course website up and running with just these three, you know, completely free tools. And finally comes MOOC. MOOC is complete course. It is formal education. You know, it's basically a component of the formal education, because it is, you know, it offers a certification. So openness is the biggest hallmark of a MOOC course. So the top universities across the world is offering the MOOC course, and the enrollment is free and totally free course. All contents are free. So that is by definition the MOOC is. So, you know, instead of going to a foreign university for a foreign degree, you might know it is extremely expensive, right? Going abroad, for example, Japan is a very expensive country, and getting a degree from a Japanese university, you would need to shell out a lot of money. But through the MOOC, of course, you can get a first class degree, for example, in robotics or marine biology from Japanese university. So everything is free. And it is part of the open source initiative. The one video which I already covered is Jitsi. Jitsi is for the video conferencing, which is also an open sourceware, and open access initiative too for the publication. You know, the openness is what the MOOC is all about. So courses include that taught by the faculties from the top ranking Ivy League universities like Harvard, Cambridge, Yale, Princeton, and all, you know, MIT, all these things. So I suggest you strongly take up a course through the edX or Coursera that greatly develop your career profile. Like Justice, you can take it. And if you pass all the tests, course completion certificates can be bought for a nominal fee. So of course, Justice, you need to shell out around 3000 rupees, but it's really worth, you know. Or there are a lot of free courses as well. One example would be the Elements of AI. It's completely free, including the certification. However, the credits that you earn through the MOOC cannot be used for existing academic programs anywhere in the world, except a few universities abroad. And obviously, we cannot use those credits in India. So even though you got a you know, valid credit from Harvard University, you cannot claim that as part of the Anna University in Chennai, for example, because we really don't have that kind of global credit transfer mechanism. But still, it's worth, because it is a goal oriented. It's not really at, you know, the establishment driven or a degree oriented education, right? The MOOC, you're actually learning something really good, you know, and it's not merely for the certificate purpose. And yeah, to add on, the certificates are really still valid if you're applying for a course abroad, or, you know, applying, for example, you are trying to study abroad, applying for a foreign scholarship. If you have a valid certification through earned through the MOOC, it actually stands out. Your CV will be standing out from the crowd. And also, if you are trying for a job abroad, for example, the MOOC is really good. And of course, there is something called Global Credit Transfer, where six universities have already signed up. Delft University in Netherlands, and those things, you know, the Swiss, and Boston University in the US, British Columbia in Canada. I mean, some universities do have a global credit transfer, but well, in India, we don't really have it. Then comes our question, what is actually available in India? So we have an excellent program by the Union government. The program is called SWAYAM. And SWAYAM is actually an acronym. It stands for Study Webs of Active Learning for Young Aspiring Minds. It's a very interesting acronym. So anyway, it is called SWAYAM, and SWAYAM do have credit transfer. So whatever the credit that you earn through the SWAYAM, you can claim those credit as part of the existing degree programs. You know, it could be degree or PG level. It's a big program, and it's a flagship program of the government, and I have written extensively in Hindu. My article is Learning on the Go. Link is given in the description section of this video. And I also wrote in Malayalam in Deshabhimani and Malayalam Manorama also. The link is also provided below. So please have a look at that. So in my article, I have said this about the SWAYAM. It opens up the cloistered academic hegemony and makes high quality courses accessible to anyone, irrespective of their economic status, education level, gender, nationality, caste, religion, etc. SWAYAM brings an egalitarian, socialistic approach to the education sector. So I find this as the biggest advantage of the, you know, of the SWAYAM program. And the faculties are from Central University here in India. Now in Punjab, I work in a Central University, and IITs, IIM, ICER, etc. So, and of course, there is no entrance test for the SWAYAM course. For example, if you want to come to my university where I teach, Central University of Punjab, you have to qualify CUCET, which is one of the tough tests, very highly competitive tests in India. So if you cannot qualify the CUCET, how can you take my courses? So yes, SWAYAM, through SWAYAM you can take it, irrespective of your educational background. The same thing with JEE. JEE is also a highly competitive exam in India, and without passing JEE, can you ever imagine taking up an IIT professor's courses? Before SWAYAM it was not possible, but with the SWAYAM it has completely opened up. CAT, for example, for IIM, or KVPY for ICER and IISc Bangalore. So all these things are possible now through the SWAYAM. So this MOOC, SWAYAM, or any of these massive open online courses, compared with correspondence course, what is actually the differences? So as you see, the SWAYAM is an individual course, so subject is being offered, while IGNO or the correspondence courses are offering the complete degree. So it is not the complete degree. MOOC is only for a course, one particular course. So there is a huge shift in the the employment hemisphere these days, that more and more companies are asking for what is there in your skill basket. So that means that you are actually having a melange of different skills. For example, I know psychology, for example, if I have a course on psychology, if I have a course on education, preschool education, and another course on computer programming, then with these three different courses I can apply for a job that perfectly cater the skills of what I possess already. So that is what the skill based the trend shift in employment field. So it's a major trend these days. So that is why individual courses are much more preferred over the whole degrees. Now SWAYAM MOOC is of course through internet, while correspondence course is through the post, and it is also getting kind of old fashioned. So correspondence courses are now turning into the MOOC courses, and it's completely free, while correspondence courses are not free. And SWAYAM or any of the MOOC is faculties from Central Universities, IITs, IIM, ICER, and Ivy League institutes are being offered. But in the case of correspondence courses, are usually faculties from IGNO, that is Indira Gandhi National Open University, or other offering universities. Many of the state universities do offer correspondence courses. One good example would be my own alma mater, University of Madras in Guindy. SWAYAM or MOOC fosters two-way learning, because there is a discussion group, and peer group discussion is also being fostered through the SWAYAM. At the same time, for the correspondence course, there is no two-way learning, it's only one-way learning. You're only learning, so there is no way to interact with your instructor or other classmates. Now MOOC versus traditional classroom, what is the difference here? So MOOC is basically you can access a course from anywhere while traveling in a bus or at night, etc. So this is extremely convenient for those who have jobs or parents on maternity or paternity leaves and so on. While brick and mortar classroom, the traditional classroom, is you need to be physically present in the classroom, and if you miss out, you cannot rewatch the schedule, the lectures. And the MOOC is free or less expensive, while brick and mortar, the traditional classrooms, are not free, and it's mostly highly expensive. If you really want to get into a premier institute, you really need to spend a lot of money. So the traditional classroom tend to be extremely expensive compared with the the online classes. Though many people will say, okay, you need to have internet for it, but internet is coming much more cheaper these days. And if you compare the whole course, the entire money that you invest in an online course versus the traditional classroom are much, much more expensive. And that is the reality. And it's more like the brick and mortar or the traditional classroom is kind of a luxury these days, while the MOOC is not really a luxury. MOOC is for the common man. And anyone, irrespective of the age or qualifications or nationality, can go for it. But this traditional classroom is only for the limited number of students who pass through the entrance exam. And you can watch the class video as many times as like. And this is very important while learning a new concept, as studies have affirmed that frequency of revision plays a crucial role in etching the concept in our long-term memory. It's very important. While the traditional classroom lecture only once, and you're gonna miss if you're absent in that class or if you bunk the class, so you cannot re-watch that video. And students can pause and pause the class and take notes, rewind, forward as may they prefer. But it's impossible in the case of the traditional classroom. So there are a lot of advantage of the MOOC or the online courses over a brick and mortar classroom. And this is a very important study on exponential nature of forgetting, how we forget. And this study is a landmark study by German psychologist Hermann Ebbinghaus. So according to this Ebbinghaus, we actually forget 50% of what we learned within 1 hour of learning it. As you see, in x-axis is the time since learning, so elapsed time since learning. And now this y-axis is basically the retention percentage, how much percentage of what we learned is being retrieved on our mind. So as you see that just after, this is the time zero, means this is where the lecture enter. So within 1 hour, the retention has drastically dropped down to 50%. So you actually forget 50% of what you learn in 1 hour. And if you simply go on and on, after 1 month, it's almost like 30% only what that remains. That's very important, that it's important to revise what we learn. So that is exactly what this interleaved thing. So instead of blocking means learn the first unit, then second unit and third unit. So it's better to learn little bit from first unit, second unit, third unit, and again go back to first, second, third, again go back. So repeated learning of the same thing is very important. So as the rewatching the same video again and again is extremely important. So as you can see that it's actually going down. This is Ebbinghaus curve. It goes down within 1 hour, and you take the first review, it boosts up again to 100%. Then second review will happen. See that the space, as you can see here, these dots are, the space between these dots keep on increasing. So that is basically the property called log or exponential nature of this curve. So the space between zero and first review is much smaller than first review and second review. And second review to third review, you can take a lot more time. For example, 2 days. And after third review to fourth review, you can go for more time, maybe 1 or 2 weeks, then month or a year. So that way, this is how actually the memory works. And MOOCs foster something called two-way learning, because you can pose questions to instructor, get cleared through the online forums, and interact with other peers, other group members through. While in contrast, the one-way learning or self-learning let the students access the contents only without any interaction. But mind that not all e-learning foster two-way learning. One good example would be Open Courseware or OCW by MIT. It's a famous example of online content delivery, but it's only a one-way learning. There is no way you can interact with the MIT professors. Other examples of the one-way learning include Doordarshan's Gyan Darshan, YouTube, TED, or that is TED Talks, radio, TV, a textbook, etc. EPG Padhashala is also a project by the UGC that is also completely, it's only one-way learning. So it is being repurposed to Swayam. Many of the courses are now converted to the Swayam. Swayam Prabha DTH channel, there are 32 channels on various subjects repurposed from the Swayam. This is also one-way learning. Coming to Swayam, Swayam courses have got 4 quadrants. So what are these quadrants? So as you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4. The first quadrant is e-tutorial, which could be video lecture or audio podcast. Then e-content, e-contents are e-text and or books. And web resource could be further reading, references, online video, online articles. So those are not yours, you're linking up with some other resources. So that is called the web resource. And finally, self-assessment, MCQ, assignment, term paper, these are for the evaluation, right? So these four components plus discussion group. That is very, very important component of any of the MOOC courses. Don't forget it. Without discussion group, you cannot call your course as a MOOC, you know, unless you have unless you foster the two-way learning. So UGC has released something called Credit Framework for Online Learning Courses through SWAYAM. So in 2016, so it is issued in July 2016. So the courses that you take, anyone take through the SWAYAM, are permitted for the credit transfer across all universities and institutes in India. So up to 20% of the courses in a program, that is a degree or a postgraduate degree like master's, can be on the SWAYAM, you see. So SWAYAM courses can be a substitute for the core courses or elective courses. It could be you know, the discipline specific elective or skill based elective, whatever the elective courses, or interdisciplinary courses. So it can be substituted for any kind of courses. And SWAYAM to notify the courses on June 1st and November 1st of every year of the new courses available. So PG courses in the SWAYAM is now managed by CEC, that is the Consortium for Educational Communication, since 2019. So earlier it was handled by UGC, but now no more, it is now with the CEC. Because CEC is handling, CEC itself is having many of these media centers. So the video recording, editing, etc. will be done in one of the 22 media centers of the CEC. And these media centers are known as Educational Multimedia Research Center, or EMRC. It is affiliated with some of the old universities, you know. For example, here in India, in Punjab, where I live, we have a Punjabi University in Patiala. They have an EMRC center. I'm affiliated to that center. So faculties would need to visit these centers to record the lectures, and all the post record processing, website upload, maintenance, etc. will be done by the EMRC staff. So faculties don't have to, I don't really have to work on all any of these things for the complete MOOC that I offer through the SWAYAM platform. So this is another site, the EMRC at the Anna University in Chennai, Madras, and they have a very good, you know, one of the 22 CEC EMRC centers in Anna University. So this MOOC comes with something called modules. So what is this module? It's something like units in the syllabus. So usually a 3-credit course is divided into 30 modules, while 4-credit course is into 40 modules. So each module is complete, you know, it just covers everything, including the questions, you know, and all these 4 quadrants which I explained. So everything has to be in each module. SWAYAM courses are between 12 to 15 weeks. So it depends upon the credit. 12 weeks for 3 credit courses, while 15 week is for 4 credit courses. 3 credit course each week will cover 2 modules. So it all depends how you plan it, you know. So contents will be released on the schedule. Each module video lecture would be approximately 40 minutes long and e-text of 3000 words. So, you know, if you are developing the MOOC, so majority of your time will be devoted for developing an excellent PowerPoint presentation, highly updated, plus this e-text of around 3000 words for each module. So if you are developing a modest 3-credit course, so you would need to develop 90,000 words, you know, it's something like a book. So you need to spend considerable time, and mind that in PPTs you are not allowed to use any copyrighted material, the videos as well as the images or animations, you know. And for the e-text, there is no plagiarism allowed, so 0% plagiarism. So all this originality has to be ensured. And this 3000 words of each module will be divided into 3 sections, each around 13 minutes of the video and e-text of 1000 words. So it is much more easier for the students to follow short segments of the video as well as short essays. So student time commitment is a weekly time commitment, approximately 3 hours per week. That includes 80 minutes of the video, 80 minutes of the reading or problem solving, 20 minutes of the assessment. Overall time commitment is around 45 hours, including 20 hours of video, the whole course. One example week, this is what I follow in my course, is that Sunday, for example, this is the one whole week. So the first day I release the module 1, section 1. So Sunday, Monday, Tuesday is for the module 1, section 1, 2, 3. So section, each section is for video of 13 minutes and reading for 1000 words, you know. And Wednesday I release module 2, section 1, then 2 and 3. So at the end of each module, I put an ungraded test. So the students will know the answer instantaneously. And it's very important to know that are they actually progressing or not, are they learning or not, or if they really want to rewatch their video, they can rewatch it after this ungraded test, right? So that's very important. So again, second ungraded test here in the Friday. And finally, on Saturday, I'll release the week number one or two, whatever the week, this week's graded test. So that is for two modules. So that will be that whatever that answer the students put in will be counted towards their final grade. And each week I begin with a brief introductory video, approximately 2 minutes long. And each week will also conclude with a brief sum up video. So usually I release the sum up video before this graded test. So it is something like a revision for them to see that what we have covered in that video in that week. And discussion forums are really important, and it's moderated. You know, online discussion forum where students can interact with each other and with the instructor. So relevant topics the students can discuss in it. So use a forum for general interaction with other students, how-to questions, other clarifications, group assignments. So this discussion forums are really, really a core component of any MOOC courses that you teach. And how the assessment work. So as you can see in this pie chart, 70% of the huge chunk of this assessment is basically the final exam. And that is a proctored exam. Proctored exam means students have to physically go to an exam center and they have to take that exam, a supervised exam. There will be examiners in the center. They are not allowed to carry their mobile phones or any book, you know, and they will have to do a computer based test. So that is, or it can be a normal pen and paper test as well, right? Proctored exam. That is conducted by National Testing Agency in case of SWAYAM and through the select centers. Till last year, NTA has a deal signed up with TCS, that is Tata Consultancy Services, and they were doing this, conducting this, the centers, this proctored exam in select centers. Rest 30% is what you get through online tests. This is nothing but continuous assessment. So this is how any of the SWAYAM MOOC courses work. So SWAYAM vertical means it's not merely the PG, but it can be of the UG level as well. So CEC SWAYAM is responsible for all non-technology undergraduate courses and postgraduate courses. While NPTEL SWAYAM is responsible for the technology graduate and postgraduate courses. You know, for example, engineering courses are offered through the NPTEL. And IGNOS SWAYAM offers diploma and certification courses, while NCERT or NIOS SWAYAM offers grade 10 and grade 9 level courses. So even school level, there is actually a trend for the MOOC. So all courses can also be taken as part of the lifelong learning. So immaterial of your education status or employment status. So anybody can take these courses to, you know, to improve their understanding of the subject, learn something new. So learning modes include blended or hybrid or flipped classroom. What does that mean? It's blends online and traditional for the campus student. For example, in my case, I offer the online course and the traditional classroom courses. So before the COVID-19 lockdown, of course, I used to teach, in the university. Now that everything has been shifted to the online mode, right? So I do something called flipped classroom. I'll come to this term in a short while. Online is another mode. Online means only online. Anywhere, anybody can take this. Most of the MOOC courses are only online. Now come to dual mode. So blended. So as I was telling, hybrid, flipped classroom, plus equivalent online. So this is exactly the method that I follow, because I already have a MOOC course in SWAYAM. So I ask my students to go and take that course. But the class in-class discussion will be happening in my university campus. I foster the discussion and the exam will be conducted in my university. So it's a dual mode. And open is online with open entry, like Open University or MOOCs. So that is what another of the e-learning modes. So MOOCs facility is something called flipped classroom. What does that mean? So it's a new term which is in force for the last 3-4 years. So flipped classroom method is that before a class begins inside the classroom, students at home, for example, take the lectures, you know. So student prepare to participate in the class activities. So for example, if you record the videos and put up in the YouTube, I ask my students to watch those videos, watch the lectures beforehand, before coming to my class. And I use my class for you know, practice applying key concepts and feedback. So a lot of discussions happening in the class. So there is no lecture, direct lecture, you know, monotonous lecture doesn't happen in the class. So students come up with their doubts and you know, the classroom will be converted to discussion and problem solving and Q&A. And after the class, they go back and then they check their understanding and extent of their learning by assessment, and they also review the concepts again by re-watching the videos or reading the e-text materials. So traditional classroom is the instructor prepares the material that can be delivered in the class, students listen to the lectures and other guided instruction in the class and take notes, and then they do the homework, you know. But in the flipped classroom, the role is changing. At home, they are actually watching the video and they're converting the classroom as to perform the homework, you know. It would become classwork, and they are actually discussing many things with the teacher as well as a peer group discussion. So it's a lot of discussions, lot of immersive experience in the case of flipped classroom. So it's really nice. So this one is a very important landmark study by Richardson V, constructivist pedagogy. So what he called it as social constructivist theory of pedagogy, where you know, the research have repeatedly said that students don't really learn anything in the class. So you know, the traditional classroom where the teacher oriented, where the teacher is considered to be the god, is highly skewed approach. Most of the learning that the students make is by the peer group discussion and critical reflection, practice by doing and teach others for the immediate use. So those are very important but often overlooked in traditional classroom. The traditional classrooms are, you know, the didactic monologues where the teachers lecture for hour long, and where it's a highly ineffective strategy in pedagogy concerns. So that is why a flipped classroom is very advantageous, because it fosters a lot of discussions. So if you compare the traditional classroom with a flipped classroom, traditional classroom overemphasizes the teachers, while flipped classroom emphasizes on the students. And traditional classroom is teacher centric, while flipped classroom is student centric. It promotes a rote learning, not good at all, the traditional classroom, but the flipped classroom promotes curiosity or discovery learning. Traditional classroom is mostly didactic monologues, so boring lectures, you know, like the radio shows. There is no other interaction with the teacher, right? But in the case of flipped classroom, more peer group discussions and group activities. And teacher-student interaction is far, far higher. Flipped class let the teachers identify the specific weakness of individual students and tailor-make her or his teaching strategy to nurture the learning, a concept known as personalized learning or personalized education. So flipped classroom do support personalized education. So in one sense, the role of teacher is you know, a facilitator for the knowledge learning process. It's a very famous quote by Albert Einstein: I never teach my pupils, I only provide the conditions in which they learn. You know, the teacher is acting like a facilitator. It's not that teacher is not a god, it's simply facilitating the knowledge discovery. Another quote from the Albert Einstein, which I like most, is: true sign of intelligence is not knowledge but imagination. You know, so that is why the discovery learning is very important, and flipped classroom that fosters the discovery learning is highly relevant in today's society. But there is why there is a lot of resistance for online learning, because a lot of people are technology averse, and there is a name for that in standard English called Luddite disposition. You know, Luddite means they don't like much technology. But no one can stop the march of progress, friends. We are ultimately going towards technology-driven, data-driven world where artificial intelligence plays a huge role. So no one can stop it. So resistance is futile. Many people say classroom teaching is an art. You know, the blackboard teaching, the chalk talk, you know, that blackboard chalk talk is an art, while they forget that instructional design is an art too. A PowerPoint presentation is also an art, you know. And boring PowerPoint presentation or boring black and white teaching, students sleep in the class, right? Even I slept in class during my college days, because the black and you know, blackboard teaching, it's an art. Of course, some teachers are really good, some teachers are really boring, so as the PowerPoint presentations too, or the online classes too. So flipped classroom could cover substantially deeper understanding of the syllabus and out of syllabus knowledge. So things that we cover in the flipped classrooms are really vast. a few tardy students might not appreciate, some lazy people, they will not appreciate. For them, the classes are only for the degrees and jobs. So something called establishment driven or degree oriented. So those students come to the classroom just to get the degree. They will not appreciate vast expanses of the knowledge sphere that you are learning through the, you know, the classrooms, by if you do the flipped classroom. Justification that only rich can afford mobiles and internet connectivity, that is it's a well-known you know, the hawks. Of course, the things are now turning, you know, the internet is now coming cheaper and cheaper as days goes by. And more than that, as I already explained, online courses and MOOCs are much cheaper than you know, the traditional classroom. So traditional classroom, the brick and mortar classroom, is kind of a luxury everywhere in the world. Considerably a lot more effort by the teacher, that is true. For online learning, teacher have to put a lot more effort than the traditional classroom teaching. Need to record the videos and make things available online, an entire repertoire of IT efforts. And as promulgating online, copyrights matter, but in the traditional classroom, copyright doesn't matter. All images, drawings and graphics need to be original, that is extremely important. So as e-text should not have any plagiarism. Write detailed lecture handouts or e-text, 90,000 words for one course. So it is something like writing the whole book. So it needs a lot of time and commitment. Plus efforts in in-class discussions, activities and personalized education. You know, so this is in addition to the effort that you put for towards online learning, right? So developing the module. So how many teachers, if you are actually teaching in a Blackboard based teaching, how many of you actually do this lecture handouts and deliver to your students? Very, very few. But in the case of online learning, lecture handout is an important you know, task that everybody has to do that. So it's a lot more systematic, a lot more organized, the whole online courses. Yet another resistance that I often came across, especially from my colleagues, is that, well, I learned in traditional classroom. Am I less knowledgeable? This is this is a question that they ask. And we can also even reword. They didn't ask it, but I can reword this the same resistance that, well, Albert Einstein learned in traditional classroom. Is he less smart? Another justification, right? So, well, you should also remember that Albert Einstein's period also had a lot of progress in pedagogy, you know. So, compared with or like Isaac Newton versus Albert Einstein. So, things keep on changing. And there is no point in resisting the technological advancement. Right now, I tell everybody to take up a course on artificial intelligence, because AI is completely changing any kind of discipline that you can imagine. So there is no point in resisting this, you know, this progress, eventual progress. So Luddite disposition is not really a good one at all. So there is another thing called cognitive dissonance. So cognitive dissonance is that, you know, if you really believe something and if somebody actually questions your core belief, then the problem that comes into your mind. You know, if you really believe that online learning is really boring, I don't like this technology, then whatever you say, the person will tell you back that, no, I resist that. So that is called cognitive learning, so cognitive dissonance. And I think this psychological phenomenon of cognitive dissonance is a big problem. You know, that is one of the main reasons why most of the teachers are not coming into the, you know, the online teaching. And here is a famous quote by ancient Chinese literature. When the student is ready, the teacher appears. And when the student is really ready, the teacher disappears. What does that mean? So only when your mind is open to receive the idea, then only the teacher appears. And if you are not open for any new idea, then whatever the teacher promulgates and whatever the hours long lecture, you will not take up anything that teacher says. Now, when the student is really ready means student has lots of resistance, you know, confirmation bias, and then whatever the teacher tells you, you know, to change your belief, then you will not take up. That is a big problem with learning, you know. This is something called confirmation bias in critical thinking, the cognitive bias. Another very interesting the quote is by Epictetus, the Stoic philosopher of ancient Rome. So Epictetus famously said that it's impossible for a man to learn what he thinks he already knows. But numerous studies have shown that the flipped classroom mode is really effective compared with the traditional mode. So that is what the published literature says. So of course, MOOC has got different challenges. So the biggest challenge is something called retention rate. Most of the enrollees quit the MOOC after a couple of weeks or even a couple of days. as there is no peer pressure to stay on, you know. So, but the students in traditional classroom will not quit easily because they are in a closed academic system. They attend the classes not out of the curiosity to learn, but just to get a certificate, you know, a degree and a job, right? So they have no other choice. They just have to continue it. The MOOC retention rate, many studies have confirmed that two important factors that contribute in this retention rate is openness and reputation. So what does that mean? Openness means, is the MOOC really open to all of them or is it closed for only few people? And reputation means reputation of the instructor. So where the instructor is from, which university, is that university or college well known? So those things are extremely important, you know. Retention rates of SWAYAM are expected to be high because UGC's credit transfer framework, because the credits that you earn through the SWAYAM can be transferred across the universities in India. That is one main reason that the SWAYAM program have got a very high retention rates compared with other MOOC courses. Now coming to the latest trend, what is happening is that as of June 2020, a large number of MOOCs in Coursera as well as edX have now adopted free preview mode. So for full content, accessible, the students have to pay, you know, approximately $100 to $200. Effectively, this invalidates openness in the MOOC, the first O, you know. It's no longer a MOOC then, it's only MOC. You know, it's not exactly open, right? So if it is open, then it has to be free. So one reason for this transformation, besides obvious profit making, is that when students pay, they're subconsciously entering a mental commitment to complete that course. It's just like movie. If you watch a movie in your home, the TV, then if the movie is not that very excellent, then you will simply change the channel. But if you already paid for around 300 rupees in a very nice theater, IMAX theater, air conditioned theater, and you paid 250 rupees, then the movie, even if the movie is not that great, you will be, you know, chances are high that you will completely watch that movie, because, you know, there is something called loss aversion and sunk cost fallacy in cognitive biases and critical thinking. So you can search out what this sunk cost fallacy is. Also, the fallacy is applicable if you are in a fancy restaurant. Even though the menu might not be that delicious, but still you eat everything, right? So this is what is happening here. So SWAYAM also charges, it's around 1500 rupees as an exam fee, but the fee is refundable if the candidate passes the test. So it is kind of a driver. It increases their motivation and commitment. So I'm really happy to be part of this great initiative by the Union government. So the challenges include SWAYAM certification requires offline proctored exam, effectively forcing the paid customers only to India, because people, for example, a person from Peru or Chile cannot take the proctored exam because the person have to come all the way to India to take that exam. So that is not practical. But people anywhere in the world can still access all the materials. Only certification is the issue, you know. Assessment in the MOOC need to be foolproof as it is online only. So any kind of tests that is online only have got this issue with cheating. The students can simply look up in the internet and answer the question, right? So how will you ensure it? Most of these online course provider like edX or Coursera or Khan Academy or FutureLearn do have something called honor code. So the students have to sign that honor code. It's based upon mutual trust, you know. So that is, of course, that's a big problem, definitely. But the purpose of the MOOC is not merely for the final exam or the certificate. The main purpose of the MOOC or any of the online course is to teach something useful to the students. So students will have to learn something. So that is called, goal oriented, not really degree oriented. So it's immaterial. The student cheat or not cheat, you know. Of course, even in the olden days, there are something called open book examination, where students are allowed to open their textbook and write the exam, right? That is a traditional mode. So it's same way, but the catch is that only 20% can be earned through the online mode, or 30% for the SWAYAM courses. But if you're taking the traditional MOOC course like Coursera or edX, the complete course, 100% you are earning through the online mode, you know. So honor code is really important. So MOOC is also a carrier of financial driver for the faculties, because developing a MOOC, of course, demands a lot of time commitment, including writing, preparation of the PowerPoint slides, diagrams, course maintenance, participation in the online discussions, coordination with the team, etc. Each module carries 10 mark in the latest PBAS API, that is Academic Performance Indicator for the CAS, that is Career Advancement Scheme. CAS API is all the terms used for the promotion for the university and college faculties here in India. This module development also factors in if you apply for direct recruitment. That means if you apply for a new job, assistant professor or associate professor or even a professor, you can claim the points that you get through this development of the MOOC. So if you develop a MOOC of 3 credits, that is 30 module, each module carries 10 points in latest PBAS API score. So that means you're going to get 300 points. So that is what the minimum requirement for the direct recruitment to associate professor. So if you simply develop one MOOC course of 3 credit, you are eligible to apply for the associate professor. You see, it's really, really important. So this is the guideline of the latest PBAS. Development of e-content or e-learning delivery process or material is 10 point per module. So if you are having 30 module, you are getting 300 points. And financing is also extremely important. So you can earn a lot of money. Of course, you need a lot of commitment as well. Then you can earn handsome amount developing the MOOC course. This is what the usually it is approximately 13.5 lakh rupees for development of 4 credit course. The complete package is 13.5 lakh rupees. So that also includes the money that you will spend for developing towards the video recording, everything. So it's one of my favorite quote. If I had 6 hours to chop down a tree, I would spend first 4 hours sharpening the axe, by Abraham Lincoln. So preparation is a key for developing any kind of MOOC courses. But however, almost 90% of the efforts are only for the initial development phase. When the MOOC is up and running, subsequent maintenance require only minimum effort, just 10%. So much better strategy would be delegation of the works. So multimedia editing, supervision, discussion, group maintenance, etc. to a dependable research student and incentivize the works. So that is what I do. I actually entrust one of my PhD student to do all this. I recruited him as a teaching assistant, and of course it's incentivized. There is a provision that the UGC will pay him directly. So this is what, if you are really interested, apply for the MOOC. There is an expression of interest by the CEC, and it's year round. It's open call. Anyone can apply at any time. And this is the latest circular released by our MHRD minister. And this circular, as you can see, that this is 19th May in 2020. There are a lot of courses available now. 42 PG level and 82 UG level. All these courses can be used as part of the existing program, and you can take up any number of courses, and whatever the credit that you earn can be claimed as part of the existing program. So it's a wonderful step by our MHRD government. So let me end this kind of long video on MOOC and flipped classes with one of my favorite quote. This quote is by Albert Einstein. Wisdom is not the product of the schooling, but out of the lifelong attempt to acquire it. Once you stop learning, you start dying. So this quote emphasizes importance of lifelong learning, friends. I'm a university professor and I still take up a lot of courses. For example, Justice by Harvard University. I love that course very much. So it's very important that irrespective of your profession or your financial status, it's always important to learn something new every day of your life. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, please click thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. And I will see you soon in my next video. Goodbye.